You guys doing all right? Praise the Lord. You look good. Tell your neighbor, you look pretty good. Terry, tell your husband, he looks pretty good. And Tommy, tell your wife, she looks even better. Hey, that's right. That's right. All right. Are we okay? I want you to turn with me to 2 Kings chapter 2. 2 Kings chapter 2. I'm going to give you a couple announcements before we get into the text this evening. This coming Sunday is our transition Sunday. We're going to start our transition Sundays. We did this last year, and what transition Sunday is when the fifth graders are actually taken into the youth sanctuary. They're taken into the youth sanctuary, and the only ones that will be in there is Pastor Jonathan, Pastor Savannah, and the sixth graders. And the reason why we do that is we try to transition the fifth graders over the year. This will take place every first Sunday. The fifth graders and only the sixth graders will be in there. And we do this to try to get the fifth graders familiar with going into youth so that when it comes time to transition, that they don't have a shock moment where they don't know anybody. They don't know Pastor Jonathan or Savannah or anyone else. We try to transition them over the year. We did this last year. We had a great success rate of our fifth graders transitioning into sixth grade. It may be difficult for you to wrap your mind around, but a lot of kids have difficulty making that transition from fifth grade to sixth grade because it's change. And even more have a harder time transitioning from high school to the main sanctuary. Because it's change. And they feel like they don't belong. And in this house, we need to make sure that everyone feels like they belong. Amen? So we just want you to be aware that Transition Sunday is going on this coming Sunday, and February the 7th. At noon at the Capitol Rotunda is the Right to Life rally up at the Capitol, and you are asked of you to take part in that if you would. And is everyone at 2 Kings chapter 2? Three people are 2 Kings chapter 2. Listen, y'all, it's a whole lot more fun if you guys get in it. Just because I'm sitting down, you know, I could stand up and preach if you want me to. I'm just trying to have fun. Supposed to have fun in church? Yeah, it isn't much fun if you don't have fun in church. Yeah, it's okay to have fun in church. Tell your neighbor, it's okay. You can laugh. You can even run if you want to. Yeah, praise the Lord. I want to talk about the second miracle of the prophet Elisha. And I want to cover this from a prophetic scope. I love these miracles of Elijah and Elisha, and I like to look at them from a prophetic scope. And the aspect is that I believe that everything in these miracles resemble or mean something. And I like to look at it, dissect it, and I had some help with this one. Olivia Anderson helped me. I want to give a shout out to Olivia. She's a little under the weather this evening, but she gave me some revelation that God gave her on this. And I think it's ironic that it's the second miracle, and the date is 2/2/22. And I'm going to read from 2 Kings chapter 2, verse 22. Didn't plan it, just happened that way. 2 Kings chapter 2, verse 19. Then the men of the city said to Elisha, "Please notice the situation of the city is pleasant, as the Lord sees, but the water is bad and the ground is barren." And he said, "Bring me a new bowl and put salt in it." So they brought it to him. Then he went out to the source. Tell your neighbor, you got to get to the source. He went out to the source of the water and cast in the salt there and said, "Thus says the Lord, I have healed this water. From it there shall be no more death or barrenness." So the water remains healed to this day according to the word of Elisha, which he spoke. Now in this miracle, I believe that all 14 double portion miracles of Elisha, I believe all 14, he is recovering something that had been lost. And in this particular text, I believe he is recovering the power and the purity of restoration. There's too many things broken in this nation. And there needs to be a whole lot of restoration takes place. There's a lot of families that's broken. A lot of relationships that's broken. Political parties that's broken. There's brokenness all around us, and I want you to understand God wants to see restoration takes place. So in this miracle, I believe that the prophet is recovering the power and purity of restoration. Look at this. The place was pleasant, but the water was poisoned. It doesn't matter how pleasant the place is around you if the drinking water is poisoned. Can I get an amen? Notice, water in the Bible represents the flow of God's presence, the direction of ministry. It can also represent the source of purification. In the New Testament, many times water represents the flow or the moving of the Holy Spirit. Jericho means a place called pleasant. So the place was pleasant, yet the city was barren. It was dry. It was lifeless. There were no trees. There were no pastures. There was no fruit. Why? Due to the poisoned water. Something happens when the water is poisoned. There's no life when the water is poisoned. I'm going somewhere with this. Some say that the water is called miscarriages in both animals and humans. But also there was no crops. Crops would not grow because the ground was barren because the water was poisoned. Notice the effect that the poisoned water had on the land. It didn't just stay where the water was, but it moves. And if something isn't done with poison, it spreads. The city represents dead, dry, powerless, passionless Christianity. There's too much dry, powerless, dead, passionless Christianity. I hit Passion Sunday. Passion. Sometimes you have to stir up your passion. I don't feel like it. I didn't ask you how you felt. Very few times will God ever ask you how you feel. How many of you have ever gone to work when you didn't feel like it? How many of you kids ever went to school when you didn't feel like it? There was a rule in our house. If you're not throwing up, you're going to... There's two rules. If you're not throwing up, you don't have a fever, you're going to school. Why? Because we don't want to deal with you at the house. God help y'all with COVID. I'm thankful our kids are grown and gone. I tell you, you all parents that have kids at home today, you need extra prayer. You deserve extra blessing. It's rough. Listen, raising kids isn't for pansies. It's rough. So now, not only do you have to earn a living, now you got to educate your kids. Or you got to make sure they're being educated. Hey, I'm thankful for technology, but I'm sorry. This thing of virtual learning is virtual crazy. And we need to pray for this nation because I'm concerned that there could be an educational deficit hit this nation in the next few years. How'd I get there? I'm not only concerned about the education system. I'm concerned about the church because all of this has crept into the church. We've grown dead, dry, stagnant, powerless, and passionless. You need to stir up your passion. Okay. We have no trouble going to a football game and getting passionate. How many of you watched a football game this past weekend? How many of you just sit there and never said a word? Stacy, I'm sorry, but I think I got to call out something here. I can't imagine you sitting there, Chris. I can't imagine your wife sitting there and not saying a word. How many of you yelled at the TV? How many got up when something happened and you at least went, yeah? Why can't we do that in God's house? Touchdown happened. Yeah! Who's going to hear you? Nobody. Your wife won't even stay in the room. That's why you were silent, because you... Nobody. But then we come to God's house. Oh, I can't do that. I can't shout. I can't clap my hands. Some of you even ran around the living room when a touchdown was made. You can't run in church. You need to shake that old dead mindset off. That passionless mindset. I've said it before, I'll say it again. I'm concerned that there is being an emotionless kingdom trying to be birthed in God's church. Where we feed this lie that it's wrong to feel, you shouldn't feel, and you can't feel. And I got to be honest with you, I like to feel. Do I always feel? No, I don't. But when I don't feel it, you won't know it. Because if we're only passionate when we feel something, we're in trouble. You need to be passionate about the kingdom of God, the moving of God, the stirring of God, whether you see it, whether you don't, whether you feel it or whether you don't. You need to be passionate about it because you'll never receive what you're not passionate about. Yeah.
Preach, Pastor, preach.
The city represents dead, dry. Listen, I'm not going to shut up. I'm not going to stop being passionate. It's the one thing that got me where I am is being passionate. And if you're not going to get passionate, you might want to find somewhere else that isn't passionate.
Did he just say that?
Yes, he did. No, I'm not saying you have to run. I'm not saying you have to shout. But if you're going to smile, smile with passion. If you're going to raise your hand, raise it with passion. Because I tell you, the kingdom of God suffers violent, and the violent take it by force. We need to be passionate and pursuing after the kingdom of God. This isn't even part of my message. We need to be passionate about pursuing after the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Why? Because you're not going to attract somebody to Jesus by being dry.
Well, you want to come to church with me?
Why? You were there? Then you met Jesus. Now your whole world got turned upside down. Started praying in tongues, you're asleep. Huh? Got baptized in the Holy Ghost in sleep. Baptized 11 people Sunday night. I can't remember his name. He come up. He started praying. I said, hey, man, I said, you come up and pray over your brother here. He come up and started praying. I said, hey, I said, you can pray in the Holy Ghost if you want to. And, man, he launched out. I'm like, whoo! It's not the first time he's been here. I didn't realize that the guy he was praying for, one Wednesday night, he knelt down here and he gave his life. He accepted Jesus here. He stood up. And when his friend who led him to the Lord stood up, his buddy started praying in tongues. He got baptized, filled with the Holy Ghost at the same time. We need to know about this kind of stuff. Why? Because it stirs something up on the inside of it. It lets us know that what is still obtainable. Yeah. Calm down, Pastor. I don't plan on calming down anytime soon. Passion, passion, passion.
Better not say that.
The church, listen, a church, Jesus, this is the church that Jesus describes in Revelation 3:1. That you have a name that you are alive, but you're dead. I don't want that to be God's church today. I want God's church to be alive. Like I said, you don't have to shout every time you turn around. That can get a little redundant. But passion. Let people know you're passionate about your relationship with Jesus. Let them know that you're thankful for what he's done in your life. Let them know that he's your provider. He's your healer. He's your sustainer. He's the giver of life. He's the savior of your soul. And I'm going to move on. Listen, I said it Sunday that I'm concerned that we can get so familiar with what isn't right that when Jesus makes it right, we'll be afraid of it. Should I? Listen. Woo. Yeah, okay, Terry. I believe that the Holy Ghost is on the verge of making his church right. And when he makes it right, I'm concerned that a whole lot of Christian folk going to be afraid of it because Jesus made it right. Tell your neighbor, say, don't let it be you. When it gets wild and crazy, don't run in fear. It just means Jesus made it right. And I also have a concern that we can get so familiar with what isn't right that we don't recognize when it's wrong. Well, preach on. Elijah had established a school of the prophets in Jericho. And these young men were students of the scripture. They had even seen, they'd even had some prophetic visions according to 2 Kings 2:5. But something was clearly missing in the city of Jericho. There was a school of the prophets there, now get this, but there was still something clearly missing. The power, the anointing, and the authority of the Holy Spirit was missing. They had studied scriptures, now get this, they could witness to people, they could preach, they could speak of miracles, but they had never experienced the power of God for themselves. It isn't just enough to talk about it. It isn't just enough to tell someone about it. We need to experience the power of God for ourselves. We need to step into it for ourselves. Stop taking someone else's word for it and try it out for yourself. Look at this. Notice what was the first thing that the prophet Elisha did after Elijah was taken. He picked up the mantle and he stepped into the Jordan. He stepped into it and he tried it. Where's the Lord God of Elijah? And the waters parted. He stepped into it himself. In the kingdom of God today, we're afraid to step into something. We're afraid that we might be wrong. Yes, sometimes you're going to be wrong. If you want a prophet that gets it right every time, you're going to look a long time. Because I don't care how good someone is, they're going to miss it sometimes. But you cannot be afraid to step into it. You can't be afraid to take a risk. Sometimes you got to try it for your. I'll never forget the first time I preached that there was something burning on the inside of me when I was sitting in the pew. When I was standing up, it was burning. And I knew it was in there. And I remember getting up to preach and I was real meek and mild. And I just wasn't preaching the way I saw it, Kelly. I wasn't preaching the way I felt it. I was afraid to because I was afraid that I might miss it. I was afraid I might offend someone. I was afraid that I might look like a fool, but it got to a point, Pastor Jay, that I couldn't take it anymore, and I just cut loose and let it go. And it did offend some. And I have missed it sometimes. I remember one guy at my first church, he came up, he said, hey, I like the message you give, I don't like the way you give it. Well, that's too bad. You can't compromise how God uses you. Because God created you in His image the way He wants you to operate. I'm not going to get through this message all tonight. Sometimes you have to step in it. Listen to me. Oh, God. The Lord has put some of you in a position to lay hands on the sick and watch them recover. But you're intimidated to do it because you might look like a fool. You might. But you also may experience a miracle. But you'll never experience a miracle if you don't take a risk. Take a risk. Step into it. Witness to somebody. I'm afraid I might mess it up. You might. But God is able. God is able to take what you thought was a mess and make something out of it and watch someone get saved. Tell your neighbor to take a risk. The true key is this, is just you just have to experience Him for yourself. You just have to pick it up and step into it. Take a risk. Head knowledge cannot take you where the Holy Spirit wants you to go. You can't think your way there. You can't muster your way there. You just have to go. Well, in 2 Timothy 3:5, the scripture says this, having a form of godliness but denying its power. There is power in salvation, but the true power of salvation can never come through you unless you operate in it. Don't deny the power of the kingdom of God. Don't just sit on it. Share it. Someone shared it with you. Someone prayed with you. Someone prayed for you. Step into it. Romans 8:11. But if the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, listen, you have resurrection on the inside of you. I don't care how passionless you are. I don't care how dry you may feel. There is still, if you are bought by the blood of Jesus, there is resurrection on the inside of you. You didn't save yourself. The blood of Jesus saved you. Him hanging on the cross, that act saved your soul. When you surrender your life to him, that is on the inside of you. So that when you lay hands on someone, that's to be transferred.
I didn't feel anything.
Doesn't matter. It happened. Sometimes you feel it. Sometimes you won't. Sometimes you're going. God's about to rattle somebody's cage. Because he's dealing with you. He's dealing with you about praying for someone. And you're going to lay your hands on somebody. And they're going to fall out in the Holy Ghost. You're going like, what did I just do? Let me just tell you, you didn't do anything other than be obedient. I remember when my son Evan and his friend Cody, they were two troublemakers. He takes after his mom's people, not me. And they went to youth camp with Maranatha Fellowship. It's when we were pastoring down in Enterprise. Joey took our kids with the kids from Maranatha, and my troublemaker son and his troublemaker friend, we were just glad they went to youth camp. We fought. They wasn't going to go. I don't want to go, Dad. I said, I don't care what you want. You're going to get on that bus, and you're going to go, and you better not cause me any trouble while you're there either. And I threatened him. I did everything I could. And I was just praying they wasn't going to call me, come get his rear end at church camp. And little did I know that something happened in that church camp. Somehow or another, you think your kid's too thick-headed for God to get through. God is able. And I'm not saying that it happened and everything was perfect from that point on, but something happened. Melinda, something happened that was uncommon. That for some reason, my son and his friend, they were told to go pray over somebody. They went up, laid their hands on somebody. I can't remember if they're playing the drums or whatever, and they fell out. And Evan was like, what happened? He experienced something he never had. And he'd not had a mom and dad said, I don't care what you want, you're going to go anyway. I paid for you to go, you're going to go. He would have never experienced that. Step into it. There is somebody that is waiting for you to step in and operate in what God's called you to operate in. You have resurrection shut up on the inside of your bones. God's given us that authority. The message and the power of God, now listen to this. The message and the power of God is tainted when we call good evil and evil good, and when we stop dealing with our own sin. When we get more concerned about the size of our gatherings than we do being consumed with his presence, his power, and the conviction of God, it becomes tainted. And listen, we live in a world that calls good evil and evil good. And we live in a world that tells you it's okay, there's many ways to heaven, and they are lying to you. There is one way to heaven. His name is Jesus. That's what the Word of God says. There's no way around it. There's only one way to heaven. You can't worship Buddha and get to heaven. It's Jesus. He's the only way. There's one way and multiple ways. You can chant, you can dance, you can do whatever you want. It's only by the blood of Jesus. I pray I'm not boring you tonight. There's only one way, and it's through Jesus that we're going to make it to heaven. And we need to start dealing with our own sin. Let's stop making excuses for what we want to condone and what we want to do. And if it's sin, it's sin. The Holy Ghost convicts that we, how many of you know what I'm talking about? Anybody ever been convicted? That you do something, you're like, ooh, doggone, missed that. And then you kind of brush it off, you kind of make an excuse for it, sweep it under a rug, it's okay. And you do it again, and boom, there it is again. And you sweep it under a rug, you sweep it under a rug long enough, you'll trip over it. Thank God for the conviction of the Holy Spirit, because that conviction is our guide to let us know when we are in error and when we're right. And when we're wrong, it doesn't mean God hates you. It just means He's correcting you. How many of you ever had parents that corrected you? And they said, they lied to you when they whipped you. Anybody ever been whipped and lied to you, said, this is going to hurt me more than it is you? I don't know. I don't know about that. I've been on both ends of that. And I got to be honest, it didn't hurt me near as bad to give it as it did to receive it. And then they said this, I'm doing this because I love you. And when you're a kid, you're like, yeah, right. And you become a parent and you're like, that is right. God's the same way. He corrects those He loves. He's a father that loves us. He's a father that doesn't want us out there destroying ourselves. It isn't because we make Him look bad. It's because we're destroying ourselves. And He wants to see you in heaven. He loves you so much that He'll convict you. And He'll keep calling your name and calling you back. He'll even bring you to a church service or accidentally tune in online to something, a message like this. And it's Jesus saying, hey, I love you just the way you are. I just want to save your soul. And that conviction comes down. Why? To correct us. There needs to be an encounter, an experience is needed. In 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 20 and 21, and we'll get ready to close this out. And he said, bring me a new bowl and put salt in it. So they brought it to him. Then he went out to the source of the water and cast in the salt there and said, thus saith the Lord, I have healed this water. From it there shall be no more death or barrenness. Get this. He said, bring me a new vessel. Put salt in it. I'm going to take it to the source. Notice he said a new vessel. This was a vessel that was set apart. A new vessel just means it's set apart. Means it's covered by the blood. It's experienced the power of God. I'm talking about vessels being people. Just as God wanted to use a bowl, He wants to use you. But he wants to use you after you've been covered by His blood and after you've experienced His power. He said, bring me a new jar and put salt in it. Salt is a preservative. Now get this. He said, bring me a new jar with a preservative in it. I believe he was saying something like this. It's an old revelation preserved for later to be put into a new container. What's the old revelation? Purity that comes from the blood of Jesus. And put it in a new vessel because I want to use them to bring about purity. Think about that. I'm probably going to step in something right here. He said, bring me a new vessel with a preservative in it. Something that's been around for a while, but it still has life in it. Now, most of you know, Mamaw, my mother-in-law, is teetering between here and heaven still. She's a fighter. And constantly in the room, we have the Gaithers playing. It's an old preservative that many's overlooked and said is useless anymore. Oh, But I sat in that room yesterday preparing this message with that old preservative playing. Hear the song called Home. Where there is no night, home. And I don't want to sing anymore. But Terry, something started to stir on the inside. I won't sing about heaven anymore. I don't know why. But you could say what you want to about those old songs. I'm telling you, man, there's something in those old songs that stirs this old boy up. Now, I'm not saying that's all you got to sing, but I'm saying there's still life in some of those old songs. There's coming a day. It's all got to hear, man. And oh, how about, oh, what a day that'll be.
What a day it'll be.
Huh? How about that one, Ricky? When my Jesus I shall see. And when I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. And when he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land. What a day. Oh, what a day. I don't know. Maybe it's just because I've been sitting beside someone who's teetering between heaven and earth. I don't know. But I tell you, I think we need to think a little bit more and sing a little bit more about heaven. It's caused a lot of conversations in our home lately. Last night, Evan and Alyssa's over. Y'all, I'm not going to finish this message tonight. So Andy, you might want to go ahead and prepare, because maybe we'll finish it next week. I don't know, but it's caused a whole lot of conversations in our home. Last night, Evan and Alyssa come over, and it was, whew. Last night, I didn't have a son and daughter come over, Shelby. I had two friends stop by the house and just love on us. Strange when your children enter into a place as friend. You can't be a friend to your kids when they're young. But after they get up there to a certain, I don't know, am I right or wrong about this, Terry? But when they get to a certain place, it's like they become your friend. And they're able to pour into you and love on you. Like, hey, wait a minute.
Is that my kid?
Right? Right? He definitely must take after his mom's people. We were talking about those old songs and singing about heaven. And Evan said, he said, hey now, he said, I'm all about going to heaven. He said, but I don't want to rush it. He said, I want to go. He said, but I want to live my life. He said, I want to raise my kids. I said, you know what, Evan? I said, I remember being your age and feeling the same thing, but I'd never vocalize it because I was afraid of being put down, because I did. I said, but son, there's nothing wrong with feeling that way. Just be ready in case you don't have much longer. And then he said, you know, he said, then Pastor Terry, he said, I hear Pastor Terry talking about heaven, and he believes he'll see it in his lifetime. And he said, I want to go to Pastor Terry. He said, hey, Pastor Terry, calm down. He said, I want to go see Pastor Terry. Calm down. He said, I know you got clout with God. Calm down. He said, everybody knows Pastor Terry lives a little bit closer to Jesus than the rest of us, and he's afraid. And he said, I'm afraid that he might listen to Pastor Terry and come, and I don't want him to come yet. laughed and we cried. But I wouldn't trade the conversation about heaven for nothing. There is coming a day. That Jesus we shall see. And I pray that when that day comes, I pray that we're all ready to meet him. This isn't the way that I had planned to close this message tonight, but it's where we are. I don't know, there's been a stirring on the inside of me the past couple weeks that, man, you got to get ready. You got to be ready. You got to be ready to meet him. We can't be playing games. There isn't time to entertain stuff that isn't valuable in the kingdom. Perfect? I'm not talking about perfection. I'm talking about being ready. I'm talking about being saved. I'm talking about being washed in the blood of Jesus. That's old-fashioned, Pastor. Then you call me old-fashioned. But by God's grace, I'm going to teach you and preach to you what you need to make it to heaven. And you can call it old-fashioned, but you won't get there without the blood of Jesus. I'm not preaching shame to you. I'm not preaching doubt to you. I'm preaching love and I'm preaching truth to you. Because Jesus loves you right where you are, the way you are. And he'll receive you just the way we are if we'll just accept him the way he is. As Savior, Redeemer, Healer, soon coming King and Judge. As you stand your feet tonight, I just simply ask you, are you ready? If there's any question, any doubt in your mind tonight, I'm just going to ask you to come get around this altar. And you just pray the way you need to pray to him. And ask him to forgive you. There's no right or wrong way. It's with a heart that's repentant that he's after. If you've grown cold, you're not as passionate, not as on fire as you once were, and you want that passion to reignite and burn again, just get around the altar and ask him to reignite that flame. What has drawn you away from the Lord? What has gotten into your life and lured you away? Whatever it is, deal with it tonight. And if everyone else, if you would just simply come get around this altar. Maybe for Thanksgiving. Come and pray for God's church. That we become powerful, passionate, alive again. Whatever it is, you come and pray. Come and pray for your kids. Your kids need it. If you have kids, if you raise your hand when I ask you if you have kids, you should really honestly come pray for them. Because your kids are facing it tonight. Whether they're teenagers or young adults, they're facing it. And they need prayer. And they need a mother and father to pray for them. So wherever you are, you just come and pray. Amen. Won't you sing us along with him tonight?
What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day. And I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be. Thank you. by the hand and leads me through the promised land. What a day, glorious day that will be. There'll be no sorrow there, no more burdens to bear, no more sickness, no more pain, no more parting over there. And forever I will be with the one who died for me. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. He takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. Look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be. Thank you.
Hey, Wayne, can I have your oil? I don't need that. I just need your oil. Thanks. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Isn't it good? Yeah. Who needs healed tonight? Who needs healed? If you do, just come up here and just stand right here. Come up and stand right here. Just make a line back through here if you need healed. Praise the Lord. You doing all right? Yeah, you're doing better than you think you are. What's your name? What is it? Tiara. Tiara? Oh, that's wonderful. Yeah. Lord set you free. Yeah. Just jump in. Oh, no. Mary Lee, you can skip ahead. Yeah. Yeah. Hey, Nate, you two come over here. Yeah. Yeah. Anyone else? If services went too long and you want to leave, you can. It's up to you. But you said you believe that healing was in the room.
There's a fire of Jesus healing. Jesus will heal. And he is here tonight, and he is going to heal, and I believe and I receive. Terry.
Everybody loves Terry. Let me tell you something. You got a whole room of people believe in you. Huh? Yeah. Yeah. You go ahead. Anoint them. They receive their healing. Hallelujah. Yep. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, you're good. Yeah. Hallelujah. It's just the power of the Holy Ghost. Be thankful for it. Oh, I'm telling you, she's going to light up like a Christmas tree. Woo! Hallelujah. Yeah. Hallelujah. Yeah. Father, increase the prophetic. Yeah. Increase the prophetic, God. Increase. Yeah. Father, just breathe on our Holy Spirit. Just breathe on our Holy Spirit. Just breathe on our Holy Spirit. Breathe on her. Yeah. Hallelujah. 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 Yeah. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Oh. Yeah.
Oh, Jesus is coming and healing it all.
Go ahead.
That infirmity is gone
in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Yeah.
Oh, I see the fire of God. I see him coming. I love
Jesus.
So proud of me.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you,
Father. Yeah. Hey, Mary Lee, come over here, honey, if you would. Yeah. Bill, come. Just come on, Pastor Terry. Yeah. Pastor Terry, come on over here if you will. Yeah. 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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yeah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Pastor Andy, go ahead and sing something if you would. Yeah, come on over here. Yeah.
Make me a vessel of your peace. Where there is war, let fighting cease. All that divides us, come reconcile us. Make me a vessel of your peace. Make me a healing streams pour down. Let the healing streams pour down. Holy Spirit, flow down. Let the waters of your presence.
We are here for you.
walls will still be loose. Strongholds will still be loose. God, we believe. Yes, we can see. The wonders are still what you do. Bodies are still being raised. And giants are still being slain. God, we believe, and yes, we can see, wonders are still what you do. We are here for you. Come and do, do what you do. We are here for you. Come and do.
Is this the baby that you saw? No, hang on. What's that? Same brown hair. You say you have two?
Yeah.
Is the other one here?
Yeah.
Where is it? Is that was it younger? This is what you saw? Praise God. Her name's Sunshine. Why don't you come over here, Christina, and help me pray for her. What specifically are we praying for Sunshine about?
Well, Sunshine, I have custody of her, and she didn't have a good life to begin with.
Gotcha.
So I can give her a good life.
Ooh. What's your name?
Caitlin.
Caitlin, were you just praying? Yeah. Caitlin and Sunshine. What's your other baby's name?
Asher.
Oh, that's a strong name. Yeah. Yeah, praise the Lord. I keep losing this oil. Jay was taking it from me there earlier. He come up and I don't know if I handed it to him or what happened. Sunshine and I'm sorry, your name again? Caitlin and Asher. Well, Father, I anoint Sunshine right now in Jesus' name. It's okay, honey. You're beautiful. You are beautiful, sunshine. You are fearfully, and I'm just going to touch your head, Caitlin. Father, I thank you for sunshine. I thank you that she is fearfully and wonderfully made. Thank you that she's made in your image. She's no mistake and she's no problem. Oh, Jesus. And Father, I pray that you would touch this mother who just wants her babies prayed over, that they would have a better life than when they started out. God, I don't know what it's been, but you didn't miss a second of it. So, Father, I pray you give this mother the desires of her heart. Give her strength. Help her to raise these babies in the way that it pleases you. May she not lean to her own understanding, but in all her ways may she acknowledge you and that you would direct her path. Father, I pray that you touch Sunshine, touch Asher, and I pray that their steps would be ordered by you and they would follow you in those steps. Lead them in all truth, I pray, and that they'd walk in that truth. And Lord, I pray that you would use them mightily for the advancement of your kingdom. We thank you for it, and we ask it in Jesus' name. And amen. And amen.
Thank you.
Don't stop praying for them and keep them close to God. I don't care where you go to church, but it's vital that you keep them in church. Doesn't have to be here, but make sure it's at a Bible-believing church. Really, I don't care where you go. Just get them to God's house because it'll help them and it'll help you. It'll help your whole family. Because of your decisions, it'll turn your family around. Don't worry. Just believe it. For you've already taken a step. Now just complete it in Jesus' name. God's been good to you. Thanks. Praise the Lord. We good? Everybody good? Woo. Thanks. What? Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah. Is he scared? It's okay. It's all right. I understand. Can I just touch your mom's back? I won't even touch you. That'd be okay. All right. Anything in particular? Thanks for willing to step in it and pick it up. Thanks for sharing the leading because I didn't have that, but it was right.
Yeah.
Thank you. You're no freak.
That's right.
You need to hear it. You're no freak.
I'm a daughter.
Ooh, yes, you are. This house believes in you. Because we see fruit. you bear much fruit. I'm thankful for you. I'm a son. I'm a son of the Most High. I'm the apple of my daddy's eye. He created me in his image. I love you. Glory to God. Your husband's back here praying over people. You imagine that?
That's a miracle. That's a miracle.
More ways than one, that's a miracle back here.
I don't think
that. We haven't seen all the fruit that's coming from that miracle yet.
Not yet.
Yeah.
But we will.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. I believe.
Pastor Jerry, where'd he go? Jay, I don't know what to do. Kelly, what do I do? You got it? How about you, John? You got it? What are we supposed to do? I can't hear you. Hey, live? Praise God. I say yes. Yes. Yeah, let's all stand. Oh, yeah. Hey, okay. Where's that microphone at? Yeah, right there. Yeah, I got. Thank you, Mimo. Hey, got a prayer request. Mimo, can I share that, Mimo? About your prayer request that you talked to me about up here tonight? About your son? Yeah. Can I share that? Meemaw has a burden for her son, Paul David, to make it into the kingdom. And I told her that even if she goes to heaven before she sees it, we won't stop crying out for Paul David. And she grabbed me by the hand and she said, "You promise?" I said, "Meemaw, I promise. I'm going to ask all of you to help me keep that promise." Let's pray for Paul David. Amen. God, save him and deliver him. Redeem him. Woo! For the mighty works of Jesus. Amen. Terry, why don't you close us in prayer if you would. You can pray in the Holy Ghost, whatever you want to do. Do whatever you want.
Father, we're just so thankful for this service. We thank you for your Holy Spirit that's been in our midst. We thank you for the lives that have been changed tonight, Lord, by your holy power, Lord. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you that you're a miracle working God. We just thank you, Jesus. Yeah. We love you, Lord, and we just praise you, Lord, for all that you've done here tonight, Lord.
Hallelujah.
We ask you to be with each
thank
one
you,
as
Jesus.
We leave,
thank
Lord
you,
God. We pray for Sister Tammy and her
thank
mother,
you,
Lord.
Yes.
Would you visit
have
her,
word,
Lord?
Jesus.
Visit them in that home, Lord. God, I pray for strength and peace, Lord, right now. Lord, we love you, Jesus. We pray for me, my old son, Paul David.
Hey.
We hold him up before you, God, and we thank you for his salvation.
Oh.
Holy Ghost, put a hook
delivering.
In his jaw and draw him to the kingdom,
saving.
Lord. We thank you for
redeeming
him, Lord. We thank you for his mother's prayers, and we thank you, Lord, that they weren't in vain, Lord God, that
hallelujah.
Her prayers, won't, Lord God,
hallelujah.
Were bottled up, Lord. And I thank you, Lord, that word that she spoke, Lord, will not come back void, and we thank you for that, Lord. We thank you for his salvation.
Yes, Lord.
We thank you that he fulfills his purpose
you,
in his generation,
hallelujah.
And we give you praise for
hallelujah.
It in the mighty name of Jesus. And amen.
Amen. By God's grace, we'll see you Sunday morning. Thanks for being here tonight. Woo! Thank Pastor Joey and all the kids workers and nursery workers for keeping your kids so late. Praise the Lord.
Eternal.